For those of you who are online, can you hear me? Great. We're going to just wait another 5 minutes or so. Till 12 o'clock to get started, inshallah. If you can just sit tight and we'll get on our way. So we're just going to wait 2 more minutes for people who are still just signing on to the live stream. Just going to wait 1 more minute before getting started, inshallah.
Yeah.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. بسم الله بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. All praises due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We thank him, we praise him, we glorify him, we beseech him to send his choicest salutations upon his most beloved sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam and upon all those who choose to tread in his path until the last day. On behalf of Dar es Salaam Travel, I wanted to just welcome you all to this live stream. We're going to be discussing how we can get spiritually ready for visiting Allah's house in Makkatul Mukarramah. So many of you who are on this live stream are either going for Hajj, you're going for Umrah, or you're just interested in the topic. But I think first and foremost, to utilize the opportunity for those of you who are going for the pilgrimage as an opportunity to just congratulate you on being able to make one of the most important decisions in your life. The idea that one would be in this place of showing the ultimate sense of commitment to Allah is not something to undermine. And to not undermine it doesn't mean to get overwhelmed by it, but in recognition that the pilgrimage to Allah's house indicates the ultimate form of expression of servitude to God, a desire of God's servant to build a relationship with Allah and leaving behind everything and anything for it. And so there's different frames that I want to utilize for the purpose of our conversation today. But before going into it, just to highlight two ways that if you have any questions relevant to this topic or just to the pilgrimage in general, there's two ways that you can ask your questions. One, there is a question and answer function, a module here on the live stream apparatus where you can type in a question and it'll show up both to myself as well as the Dar es Salaam travel agents, or you can send a question to the following email address. It's ask@darsalam.com. darelsalam.com. Again, it's ask@darsalam.com, or you can ask the question in the question box on the live stream. We'll try our best to get it answered. This session, inshallah, is going to go for about an hour or so. And again, the specificity of the topic is tied to just spiritual readiness for the pilgrimage. How is it that one doesn't just get ready in terms of what you're going to pack and what kind of belongings you should take with yourself, etc., but how do we bring back everything to the development of our internal? So I want to start off with a story that I was taught when I was younger that involves a sheikh who was walking through a forest and he saw a young man walking in the distance. And this young man was noticed by the sheikh as being somewhat unique in that his age was quite young, and he didn't really seem to have too much with him in terms of personal belongings or luggage. And the sheikh said that he also noticed that this young man seemed to be speaking or uttering something to himself. So when the young man gets close enough to the sheikh starts to ask him a few questions. The first question that he asks him is, "Where are you going? What are you doing?" And the young man, he says to the sheikh, "Ya sheikh, I'm going to Allah's house, I'm going to perform the pilgrimage." And the sheikh says to him, "That what are you saying to yourself? What are these words that you are uttering?" And the young man says that, "Ya sheikh, I'm reading Quran, I'm reciting the word of Allah, what else would I be saying? And the Shaykh says to him that you are so young, it must not be incumbent upon you to undertake this journey at this point in your life. Why are you doing it right now? Why don't you wait until you're older? And the Shaykh, he said, the young man says to the Shaykh, that Ya Shaykh, I have seen so many who are younger than me pass away before they perform this journey. Why, when I have the means and the strength to do so now, would I not do it? And the Shaykh says that you have nothing with you. There's no provisions, no belongings. Where is everything that you need to sustain yourself on this journey that's ahead of you? And the young man says to him, Ya Shaykh, if you were to go and be the guest in anyone's home, would you bring your own provisions with you? So why, when I'm going to be a guest of Allah in His house, would I take my own provisions with me? And I want you to utilize this story as a framework for how you will prepare for this journey in two ways. One, it's not really about what it is that you're going to be carrying with you externally. And that's going to be critical in understanding, and the travel agencies and your group leaders are going to be giving you lists of things in terms of packing medicines and clothes and shoes and notebooks. They'll give you books to read or insight into how you can prepare for the steps and the mechanics of the pilgrimage. But what you want to think about is not what you're carrying externally, but what it is that you carry internally to this journey. And I think the second thing that's quite critical to understand from this story is that this young man is motivated to perform this pilgrimage with the recognition that his time in this world is finite. That there is a world that is much bigger than this world that he is working towards. And to not utilize death as a morbid exercise of reflection, but one that, like many people prior to our generation, utilized the reflection of the reality of passing away from this world as a mechanism for spiritual ascension in the world beyond this one. Because their striving was not to fulfill just individual obligation or to perform ritual just for the sake of ritual, but was to see ritual rather than an ends as a means to something bigger. And so this young man in this story gives us two indications of what it is that we really need to think about. One, what does this journey mean to you? Not in regards to what it is you're hoping to gain from this dunya, from this world, but what does it serve as a means and mechanism of enhancing your recognition of the reality of the world beyond this one, your connection to Allah, and secondly, what are you bringing to it, not in terms of external preparation, but internal? Because to all of your prayer, to all of your fasting, to your work life, to your relationships, whether they're familial, parental, friendship, romantic, with your spouse, with anybody, to anything that you do, all that you bring is the presence of your heart. And if you don't know what you're carrying with yourself internally, then you're going to get out of it what it is that you put into it. The Hajj is a journey of the hearts. And so just as an individual who is performing Hajj or Umrah is leaving behind what it is that they are accustomed to in the world, in terms of their work, their home, their family, their possessions, they leave literally their entire belongings, their houses, in the physical sense, to go and be physically in Allah's house, since the ritual is not just about physical
denial, spiritually there has to be an element there. And so analogously, as your body is leaving behind what it is that it normally is accustomed to go and be with Allah, your heart also has to leave behind what it is that it's attached to in order to be as present as possible on that journey. And so where you have room and opportunity to be able to move forward in the best of ways necessitates utilizing these days and weeks to understand and recognize how you can become as spiritually aware as possible to take that journey to the best of places. I want to frame a good chunk of this conversation around an advice that comes to us from a great spiritual master in our religion's history by the name of Dhunun al-Misri, rahimahullah. Dhunun al-Misri, he speaks in one advice about something that in our tradition is called the qaswatul qalb, the hardness of the heart. And he gives us advice and indication of spiritual practice that I want to utilize as a framework through which you can think about how you physically, mentally, emotionally, and spiritually ready yourself to go on this pilgrimage. And so Dhunun al-Misri, he says, إِذَا أَرَدْتَ أَن تَذْهَبَ قَصَاوَةُ قَلْبِكَ, that if you have an irada, a desire for the qaswa, the hardness of your qalb, your heart, to go away. If you have a desire for the hardness of your heart to leave, and then he gives his first advice, فَأَدْمِ الصِّيَامِ, then endure in fasting. If you have opportunity in the coming days and weeks to fast, you should fast. The fast that is outside of the month of Ramadan is not that different from the fast that takes place within the month of Ramadan. You start out by having your suhoor in the morning. If you don't have suhoor, for a sunnah fast, you are able to start the niyyah for that fast. If you have not eaten or drank anything, up until the time of dhuhr. So if you make the intention to fast prior to dhuhr coming in for a sunnah fast, then you can make it. You just abstain from eating, drink, sexual activity during the course of the day, from the time of true dawn until sunset. Then you break your fast on an iftar. And if anyone had any indication of seriousness of their spirituality in our religion, you would see that they would adopt a regular fast. The verse that's in the Quran that says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الصِّيَامُ كَمَا كُتِبَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ, that O you who believe, fasting has been prescribed for you as it was prescribed for those who came before you, so that you might attain taqwa, consciousness of the divine, is utilized to indicate to us that we have to fast in Ramadan, but the idea that fasting as a vehicle towards attaining consciousness of God is still something that's there outside of the month. Anybody who is serious about their heart in our religion would fast regularly. And the fasting wasn't just about empty stomachs, but it's about full hearts. The recommendation in our religion is of various types if you were to seek to adopt a fast. And we're talking about this in the frame of your umrah, your hajj, being enhanced in its experience. You want to get your heart ready and as awake and alive as possible. And so the fast has the potential of rearing that. A narration comes in the Prophet ﷺ's tradition where a man comes and asks him, Ya Rasulullah, give me advice of fasting outside of the month of Ramadan. And the Prophet ﷺ tells him to fast 3 days out of the month. The middle days, the lunar days, the white days, where the moon is at its fullest. And he says, Ya Rasulullah, I can do more than that. And so he says, fast on Mondays and Thursdays. And he says, Ya Rasulullah, I can do more than that. And he says, then fast every other day, as was the sunnah of the Prophet Dawood alayhi salam, but don't do more than that. This companion is narrated as saying towards the end of his life, I wish I had taken one of the lesser advices of the Prophet rather than doing the last option that he had given to him. What we understand from this is that in our religion, it's not about a quantified aspect of doing things, but a qualified. Not how much you do, but how you do what you do. So beyond the five pillars, you pray your prayers, you fast Ramadan, you give your zakah, you do your hajj if you have the means to do so. What you're doing is about doing it well, rather than doing a lot of it. And so here the Prophet starts with an advice of fasting 3 days out of the month. From 3 days he goes to twice a week. And then from that he goes to every other day. And then he says, don't do more than that. For you, you want to adopt as much as you can based off of your strength and knowing yourself. But to utilize the opportunity of fasting to get you into the sense of how you create a state for yourself. Because when you go for Hajj, being in Ihram is not just to be in the clothing of Ihram, but it's to be in a state of consciousness and mindfulness. And so the preparation is not just physical, but mental, emotional, and spiritual as well, because you can ready yourself through that fasting of recognizing how it is that you must then engage in a certain air of conduct when you are in the state of Ihram. Because the state of fasting is different from the state of Ihram in that you can eat while you're in Ihram, you can drink while you're in Ihram, but you can't eat and drink while you're in fasting. Leave that aside, the physicality of it. But while you're in a state of fasting, the recommendations are there to not gossip, to not backbite, to not lie, to not break promises, to not curse. There's a narration where women come to the Prophet ﷺ while they are trying to fast and they seek permission to break their fast. And the Prophet says nothing to them. And the companion comes and intercedes on their behalf saying, Ya Rasulullah, these women, they are struggling with their fast. Won't you give them permission to break it? And the Prophet says, bring the women to me and bring a bowl. And he tells them to induce in vomiting. And they listen to him because it's the Prophet giving commands. And when they force themselves to vomit, to their astonishment, they see meaty pieces of flesh come out of them. And the Prophet says that they were trying to do something halal, but they broke it on something haram. That all day they were eating the flesh of their brother's back, gossiping. And because of that, their fast became difficult. And so, in adopting the mindset of the fast, to understand how it can ready you for the state of being in Ihram, because when you're on the pilgrimage, people are going to test your patience. People are going to be in your face. They're going to try to frustrate you, or things will just be frustrating. And to be able to elevate your consciousness, the same way somebody who fasts when he is met with some type of difficulty or something that causes agitation, he says, inni sa'im, that I am fasting. He's not just saying it to the person that's causing him frustration, but he's reminding himself, I am fasting. And so you should fast. And you should adopt a regular fast inside of the scope of this pilgrimage, but also beyond it. Make the commitment. Because the companion who asked the Prophet for advice and said towards the end of his life he wished he had done one of the other fasts, indicates to us that when they adopted a practice, they did it forever. They were consistent with it. And it wasn't, well, it got too easy, or this came about, because it wasn't about just, again, the physical, but yielding to the idea that there was consistent metaphysical gains. After the hunger is gone and the thirst is quenched, it doesn't mean your heart stops gaining from it. The idea that's embedded in the fasting also is about physical consumption. So some of us are not physically strong enough to fast, but the advice of the Nun al-Misri should not be something that we are dismissive of. Because in these days where you are preparing for the Umrah, for the Hajj, for the pilgrimage, you want to be conscious of everything that it is that you are consuming. And so eat to the best of your ability only when you really need to eat. We as creatures in God's creation are quite distinct from the rest of the animals that God has made. You and I cannot swim to the depths of the ocean. We are not able to fly the way some animals fly. We're not the strongest, the fastest, the biggest, the tallest. But we are arguably the only animals in God's creation that even after our stomachs are full, we keep feeding ourselves. We keep eating. The quality, again, of what you eat is just as important to reflect upon as the quantity. And so you start to ready yourself physically by thinking and assessing as to what is the food, the drink that you are going to start to consume. And what is it that you're going to cut out of your diet? If you eat garbage food, then your body will be fueled by garbage. You want to start to cut out the caffeinated beverages, things that are high in terms of their content of sugars and high fructose corn syrup, greasy, oily foods, things that you know don't have barakah to them, that physically when you drink them or eat them, they're going to make it difficult for you to retain your wudu. They're going to not give you energy. They're not going to give you strength. Eat a lot of vegetables, a lot of fruits, a lot of nuts, a lot of dates. Try to eat food that is cooked in your house. Because the restaurants, the takeout, there's not metaphysically the same type of barakah that's there as there is when you're eating food that is made from the hands of people that love you or have a deep care and affection and don't see you just as a consumer. And again, it's not haram, so long as you're not eating haram food. And if you engage in any type of haram consumption of substances, drugs, alcohols, foods that are not permissible, you want to cut that out of your system right now because you don't want your body to be fueled by it. But to understand that if you went and ate at a restaurant, that wouldn't be haram to do. But we're not talking about simply just avoiding that which is haram, but to eat and consume that which is going to be the best for the fuel of your body. Drink a lot of water. Mecca and Medina are not cold places. They are hot desert places. And you want your body now to get accustomed to detoxing from substances that it eats regularly and get also accustomed to being regularly hydrated so that your tiredness and exhaustion is not stemming from poor eating habits. And where the Nun al-Misri's advice is critical, where he says, فَأَدْنِ السِّيَامِ endure in fasting. If you fast, it starts to regulate the cycle through which you actually eat. And for those of you who observe Ramadan, you know that there is not so much by the end of it that you actually need to consume and eat. But you are able to get to a place where your body needs less and less as you go on, but you're able to do that much more. You stand into the late hours of night in the last 10 nights of Ramadan. You're able to stand and seek out Laylatul Qadr, praying until Fajr. Don't undermine that what you're consuming plays a role in getting you strong enough to reach that part of the month with that kind of strength and vigor. And it's going to be the same thing when you're on the pilgrimage. When you want to stay up all night in prayer, and you will, don't undermine yourself and base it off of what it is that you do while you live in your homes now, because you will see categorical change through the barakah of the cities of Mecca and Medina that enhance your desire, your longing to just go and be awake all night long. So the starting point has to be about food, drink, what it is that you're consuming. فَأَدْنِ الصِّيَامِ Endure in fasting. You want to also recognize the importance of how it is that you can gain in barakah just through what it is you're consuming. So in these days, share meals with people. Well, the Prophet ﷺ, he says that a meal for one is enough for two, and a meal for two is enough for three. So when you sit down to eat, enhance the blessing, the barakah, by sharing food out of the same plate as the people who are in your house, your brothers and sisters. Invite them to have meals with you. Invite them to eat meals that you have cooked with your own hand or that you have found within yourself the opportunity to engage in accepting the invitation from somebody else. But try your best to enhance your spiritual preparation by fasting and taking real account of yourself as to what it is that you are consuming and what it is that you are eating, so that you're only putting pure substances. When you get to Mecca and Medina, there's going to be food from everywhere. And the buffets in the hotel, the Burger Kings, the Pizza Huts, the Kentucky Fried Chickens, they're going to all be there. I would say as best as you can, limit the intake of that kind of food because it's going to sit with you and it's going to be present as you're moving forward in your pilgrimage. And if you can wean your body off of certain things from now, you're going to see categorical difference in the way that your body responds when you try to put it through the physical steps of spiritual ascension. It's a lot easier to be quite tired and exhausted when your body is not fueled by things that are good. The second advice that Dunun al-Misri gives, he says, وَإِذَا وَجَدْتَ قَسَاوَةً, that if you still find the hardness of your heart, فَأَطْلِ الْقِيَامِ, then make the night longer. And so the recommendation here is twofold. One, you see that in the beginning of his advice, he says, إِذَا رَتَّ أَن تَذْهَبَ قَسَاوَةُ قَلْبِكَ, that if you have a desire to leave or have the hardness of your heart leave, then endure in fasting. Now as he transitions into the second advice, he says, وَإِذَا وَجَدْتَ قَسَاوَةً, that if you still find the hardness, فَأَتْلِ الْقِيَامِ, then make the night longer, is not just about first looking at the second advice of making the night longer, but embedded in that part that says, وَإِذَا وَجَدْتَ قَسَاوَةً, that if you still find hardness. So after you've fasted, what's critical is to be reflective and contemplative and really self-reflect, be introspective, which is different from being self-deprecating and seeing, well, is there still something there? And so before we go into the second advice, a critical part of your Hajj, your Umrah being enhanced is being able to adopt very important techniques of contemplation and reflection. Because a lot of people, when they go for Umrah and Hajj, their faces are just stuck in books the whole time. They're so worried that are they saying the right thing, the wrong thing, the exact, there's not so many things that are obligatory to be said in the various parts of these rites and rituals. And you're going to miss out on huge opportunity when you don't start off by first affirming for yourself that this journey is your journey. This is your Umrah, this is your Hajj, it is for you to take advantage of. And so what you get out of it is going to be based off of what you put into it, but your needs, your desires, your strengths, your non-strengths, everything that you bring to it, it has to be subjective to you. And so where the Nun al-Misri is saying, if you still, after searching, find hardness, necessitates understanding how it is that you engage in real reflection and contemplation. Imam al-Haddad, rahimahullah, he says that reflection is the lamp of the heart. That if it departs from it, there is no light left in it. That if you just don't sit and learn how to be with yourself, to enhance a recognition of who it is that you are, which is really tough at times when we're just bombarded by the world. Days just bleed into each other. It's all about things feeding our physical, the acquisition of food, the acquisition of money, the acquisition of physical intimacy. But there's not so much that goes on about, well, what's really going on inside of me? And how do I start to reflect and understand on that? So what I would advise is two things. One, if you don't know how to be with yourself, like you can't sit in a room alone without jumping to take a cell phone or a computer or know how to just really be with you, then start your introspection by finding somebody who you can take in confidence where you just express your thoughts to them. You're in a space where you're not engaging in religion in the way many of us engage in that says, somebody else will always tell me what it is that I'm supposed to think, or what's right and what's wrong, or I hesitate in voicing my opinion or my perspective because I don't know what's good or bad, or I can only say what's good or bad. But you just find somebody where you can first hear yourself think about what it is you're thinking about by having the room and the safe space to just express what's going on inside of you. And that person that you're talking to is going to create an opportunity for you to speak because they know how to listen. They're not going to just tell you what to think or interrupt you while you're speaking, but they create a space that is safe for you to explore and really reflect. The other thing that I would say that would be key that you want to utilize right now, as well as when you are going to be on this journey, is have a journal, something to write in, so that your thoughts in real time are being written down so that you can progressively document your own growth. Because for some of us, we don't understand that even if we grow this much every day, that after a bunch of days, that growth will turn into this. But when we are thinking that this is the only indication of our growth, and we start to then undermine the fact that this is also beneficial, we're not then really moving in any direction that we can. So in your reflection and contemplation, talk to people. If you don't know who that person is, find somebody and build that relationship with them. And utilize the opportunity to just write for yourself with no one else's eyes on it, but your eyes and Allah's eyes about where it is that you are. Because in order to reach certain goals, you have to know where you stand in relation to those goals in the first place. And that necessitates real, honest, and productive self-criticism. So in his second advice, the Nur al-Misri, he says that if you still find that hardness, فَأَطْلِ الْقِيَامِ, make the night longer. Referring to perform some prayers at night. Utilize the nights for your gain. The irony of the nights in our tradition is that when the nights reach their darkest of colors, it creates the uniquest opportunity for illumination of your inside. And so many of us can be overwhelmed by this idea of saying that, well, I'm not the person who's supposed to pray at night. Qiyam al-Layl and Tahajjud have no real distinction other than if you sleep and then wake up, it's called Tahajjud. And if you don't sleep and you just pray at night, that's called Qiyam al-Layl. You can pray two rak'ah, you can pray sets of two. The Prophet ﷺ would pray four sets of two for a total of eight and then pray his witr. But to assess and understand for yourself that you go at your own pace. And this is about the heart. So the Nur al-Misri is saying that you got to get your heart ready. And to get your heart ready, take advantage of the uniqueness of the blessing and the barakah that's there. When you're in Mecca and Medina, I will almost guarantee to you that each one of you, even if you don't pray at night here, will pray while you're there. What you want to do, whether you are someone who will pray tahajjud or qiyam or not, you got to pray your five daily prayers. And not in the burdensome sense of obligation or right and wrong and good and bad, but in recognition that embedded in those prayers is unique opportunity for your heart's elevation. And when you don't pray Fajr on its time, and you don't pray Dhuhr on its time, and you don't pray Asr on its time, or Maghrib on its time, or Isha on its time, it's not about, well, what will people say, or what do people think. You're not doing right by your heart. You're cutting yourself off from an immense opportunity to build a connection with the Creator of all creation. And what you get out of it is what you're going to put into it. So I will tell you now, when you go for your pilgrimage, you're going to be, many of you for the first time, washing up an hour before the time prayer starts, ironing your clothes, making a fresh wudu, making sure you have everything ready in terms of belongings you need to take to go to the haram. Then you'll go and sit in the masjid, wait until the adhan is called. You'll pray your sunnahs, you'll pray your fard, you'll read Quran in between. Those are things you can do here also. And I'm not going to say that there's not unique blessing in Mecca and Medina. There undoubtedly is. But you don't want to undermine the fact that the actions around your prayer enhance the prayer in and of itself while you're there and just everything that you're feeling. So here too, you can decide not to pray, but then you're depriving yourself. And you can say, well, I'm going to pray, but I'm just going to do it really rushed. I'm going to throw water on my face. I'll roll out of my bed and pray in my pajamas that I was wearing at night. Or I can really start to get ready for it and embed myself in it and recognize again that what I'm going to get out of it is going to be based off of what I put into it. But for those who struggle with your prayers, try your best to pray them. If you're not praying five times a day now, then start by praying once a day. And set milestones for yourself that in the coming days, you'll add on two prayers, and then three prayers, and four prayers, and five prayers. And you make a commitment that when you go to Mecca and Medina, and you are praying every prayer in the most blessed cities, in the most blessed places, that you don't leave that behind when you leave from there, but you make a firm intention that I'm going to take it with me. And here, the Nun al-Misri, he's saying if you still find that hardness, then maybe you should pray at night. The third thing that he says, that if you still find that hardness of your heart, وَإِذَا وَجَدْتَ قَسَاوَةً, then he says, فَذَرِ الْحَرَامِ, then refrain from that which is haram. Now, a lot of us don't know what the word haram means. It has a technical definition, it has a literal definition, and the challenge is such that when we don't know what the word means, one, people can turn it into whatever it is they want to, and two, we also then kind of push back against it. And I know many of us have been judged. Many of us have been made to feel as if we're not good Muslims. Many of us have been told that everything in Islam is do's and don'ts and rights and wrongs. And there is a legalistic framework in our religion, but there's also a lot that talks about love, mercy, compassion, hope, and the combination of the two go hand in hand. And so haram is only going to be understood based off of your conceptualization of who God is. And if you believe in a God that's an angry old man in the sky, then his advice and admonition about boundaries that you shouldn't transgress for your own benefit are going to be things that are not going to resonate in that way, because you're going to be pushing back in pursuit of validation of what? When the Prophet ﷺ tells us that when you engage in haram, it puts a dark spot on your heart. And in recognition that if that darkness starts to engulf your heart, then that's the heart that you're looking at this world through. And you want to first connect to understandings of who Allah is and who the Prophet of God is. And for a lot of us, we don't ever reflect on who Allah is and who His Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is. And so when they tell us that these are parameters to not push behind, of course some of us will say that, well, what's wrong with me if I do this? In the metaphysical sense, you're going to have implications. But the pushback comes from not knowing who the Prophet is and who Allah is. So who is the God that you worship? Who is the God that you are going to make this journey for? Who is the messenger of God that you believe in that is setting for you the parameters and guidelines? There's a hadith Qudsi, a narration in our hadith that falls under the genre of hadith that are constructed via framework that says, the Prophet ﷺ says that Allah has said, and then he continues onwards with what the narration is. And so in one narration, the Prophet ﷺ says that Allah says, I am as my servant thinks I am. So the God that you worship is the God that you believe in. And if you believe in a God who is the most merciful of those who show mercy, Arhamar Rahimin, he is gentle, he is kind, he is Latif, he is the source of love, the loving one, Wadud. He is the most compassionate, Rahman, the ever merciful, Rahim. Then that's the God that you worship. But if you believe in a God that is just watching you as opposed to watching over you, then that's the God whose house you're going to visit. And in this, you can pray where people pray and do the pilgrimage that others tell you to do, but your belief has to be within you. You can't just believe because somebody else believes. It's got to come from inside. And so in thinking and reflecting, who is your God? And who is your messenger? So a lot of us were taught just pray the sunnahs. But nobody ever tells us whose sunnah we're adopting. So one of the practical advices that I would say is that in these days and weeks, you want to learn the prophetic biography. So you see how the Qur'an is lived in real time. How the Prophet adopts revelation and disseminates it, not just through words, but through his actions. This was a man who smiled at everybody when he greeted them. A man who faced in the direction of people talking to him, never showing them his back. One who greeted young and old, male and female, had companions of every race, ethnicity, social class. He embodied mercy and love and compassion in every way possible. If you're looking for a seerah, a prophetic biography to read or listen to, I would recommend listening to the seerah podcast that Sheikh Abdul Nasser Jangba does via the Qalam Institute. So you just type in Qalam podcast or Qalam seerah podcast in Google and it'll come up. There's a lot of other people who have done a seerah audio, Sheikh Hamza Yusuf, Sheikh Yasser Qadi, but I would listen to it so that you can understand the Prophet whose city you're going to visit, whose ummah you are a follower of. And then his advices and the teachings that come through the Quran that tell us to stay away from the haram, you don't tippy-toe around them, but you understand that the engagement of it is on a metaphysical level. And for a lot of us, when we think about ourselves, it's hard to acknowledge the fact that we do things that are wrong. And so you want to deepen your understanding of what haram means. Because eating pork is haram, committing zina is haram, drinking wine and alcohol is haram, but backbiting is haram, lying is haram, gossiping is haram, cursing is haram, being arrogant is haram, racism is haram. And so in these days, in these weeks, you want to stay away from all of that. Because the implications are there upon your heart. And definitely, when you are in Mecca and Medina, you want to stay away from the haram. You don't want to engage in it. You don't want to even come close to it. And so your reflection upon, well, what are those things that I might do? And how is it that I can better myself in pursuit of the elevation of my heart? Tied to what it is that you watch, what it is you listen to, what it is that you eat, the company that you keep. As best as you can, don't let yourself absorb those things. You then have a fourth advice that Dhanun al-Misri, he says, وَإِذَا وَجَدْتَ قَسَاوَةً, that if you still find that qaswa, that hardness of your heart, he says, فَسِلِ الْأَرْحَامِ, then establish the bonds of kinship. And this is really important. I see a lot of people in my office every day when I travel in this country, around the world. I have not been to a community where I've not met many people who have said to me that they have challenges and problems based off of relationships that they have. Whether it's with parents, whether it's with children, whether it's with siblings, whether it's with friends. Fasil al-arham, reestablish the bonds of kinship. You want to deal with challenges, issues, irreconciled emotion that you have, and recognize that forgiveness is not always for the one that you are forgiving, but for the one who is doing the forgiving. Because you don't want to carry that resentment, that toxicity in your heart. And you think about it for yourself, the pain that you might have experienced when somebody you care about doesn't do right by you. And now think about it from a dual sense, that you also have the potential of conveying that type of pain on somebody. And so if you are a parent, understand the importance of these days and weeks of not just telling your children what's wrong with them, but telling them that you're proud of them and that you love them. The Prophet ﷺ has a companion by the name of Al-Bara. And Al-Bara radiallahu anh, he sees the Prophet walking with his grandson on his shoulder, and he is saying, Ya Allah, love him as I love him. And so if Al-Bara heard the Prophet say that he loves his grandson, and we 14 centuries later know and understand that the Prophet loved his grandson, then undoubtedly his grandson heard and understood that the Prophet loved him. So you have to express it. You have to utilize the opportunity to deepen your love for those who are in your life and let them know that you love them. And for those that you have been wronged by, to not let yourself carry that pain inside of you, but as best as you can, remedy it. Now, I don't think that that means we should adopt an unrealistic perspective of the world, because there are some parents who are not good parents. There are some fathers and mothers who are not good to their children. There are some children who are not good to their parents. You don't want to embed upon yourself an unrealistic recognition of why it is that perhaps you are distant from some of the people in your life. And may Allah make it easy for all of us. But to understand that for many of us, we don't find ourselves in those situations, but yet, we still don't do right by those who are nearest and dearest to us. So, utilizing this time to revisit those people that you just haven't been in touch with before, or for a really long period of time. How often do you call your mother? How often do you call your father? How often do you call your teachers, your friends, those who played key roles in your life? And about what have you separated yourself from them? What is it that took root in your heart and then just bore itself into this deep animosity that has kept you away from those who you know it's not even about them, because this advice is about your heart. The harboring of that ill will is going to go with you. And so where you can make amends and you can reestablish it, spend some of these days and weeks with your family, with relationships that you might have cut off, so that it's removing that pain from your heart. The last advice that the Nun al-Misri, he gives, he says, if you still find hardness in your heart, فَأَلْتِفْ بِالْأَيْتَامِ, then be gentle to the orphan. The specificity of the advice that is tied to those that need our care, right? Like the Prophet ﷺ, he says, he who takes care of an orphan will be like this with me in Jannah. So do you want to be like this with the Prophet of God in heaven? Well, here's a direct way of doing it. Take care of an orphan. We have narrations in our tradition that say the way the stars look as they shine in the sky to us, When the angels look down on this earth, the homes that have orphans in them that are being taken care of shine to them the way that the stars shine to us. And so, if you can't bring an orphan into your home or take someone into foster care, then be in a place where you spend some of your money, you spend some of your wealth on providing for children who are in need. There are tons of Syrian children right now who are refugees whose parents are taken away from them. There are so many people who are walking through this earth who will never meet their father or mother, and we have to think for them. And this is key, right? Because the action in and of itself does not just end by the performance of the action, but it necessitates a certain type of heart and consciousness that's even thinking about people who are removed from them to begin with. So you want to ask yourself the question, if you generalize the advice now of just going and doing service and of helping people, more importantly, why are we not thinking of them in the first place? So go and work in some soup kitchens and food pantries in preparation for your Umrah and Hajj. Go and do service work, give in charity, give sadaqah. And again, it's not about how much you give, but how you give what you give. So with sincerity, with real good consciousness, and you wrestle with the elements inside of you that tell you why you shouldn't do it. Because this is what this is really about. You come into a place of self-recognition, self-awareness. One Ramadan, I left from our Islamic center with some extra food after iftar that we usually give out leftover food to people in need who live on the street who are homeless. And there was a man who was standing outside of our center that was asking for money, and I tried to give him a bag of sandwiches, and he wouldn't take the bag. And so I said to myself as I was walking away, this guy doesn't want my food, he just wants money, he's looking for money so he could buy drugs and alcohol, all kinds of horrendous things. And I took a few steps and I stopped and I realized that the only person who could answer why they didn't take the money from me was this man himself. So I went back to him and I asked him, why don't you want my food? And he went to his shopping cart and took out a bag and he said, I already have food. And if I take food from you, either your food or the food I already have will go bad and go to waste because I have no place to refrigerate it. And he said, I'm the last person who's going to throw away food. And so I said thank you to him and I walked away recognizing that the problem wasn't with him, but the problem was with how I see the world and how I do things. And so an indication to us of where we're at is about what it is that we're really doing to serve God's creation. And so you ask yourself, well, if my heart is going to be as elevated as possible, then let me go and spend some of this time in preparation of serving God by being with His creation. By understanding that the world is a lot bigger than what it is that I think about. And to go and be with people in need helps us to break a certain sense of entitlement. The last time I went to Medina, there was people who were sleeping just outside of the masjid on the floor of the courtyard around the haram. And some of our group said, you know, in seeing these people, I recognize just how good my life is and where they have difficulty. We're staying in hotels and they're asleep on the ground. And so I said to the people in my group, why do you think that you are better off than these people? These are people who, mashallah, firstly, you don't even know. They could be staying in a nicer hotel room than you just because you see them sleeping on the street or on the ground outside the masjid. What gives you indication that they don't have a nice hotel room? And secondly, giving yourself an understanding of what it is that really gives to you a sense of self-worth. Because those people have contentment. They have a certain sense of comfort within them. They are not anxious or agitated, but they know where to draw fulfillment from life. So you can live in the most expensive of homes, but if your heart is feeling internally conflicted, then you're not in a place where you possess the treasure that they do. And that's what this journey can do for you. It can give you a real recognition of what's important, what's valuable, what it is that you're chasing after. Where our Prophet, he says, لَيْسَ الْغِنَى أَنْ كَثْرَةَ الْعَرَضُ وَلَكِنَ الْغِنَى غِنَى النَّفْسِ. The true richness is not having an abundance of things of the earth, but true richness is having a richness of your soul. And your understanding of how you will engage this ritual of Umrah, of Hajj, of pilgrimage, is not going to be tied to just preparing for the mechanics, but getting your inside ready. Because your ability to engage the world around you is heavily contingent upon how you take care of the world that's inside of you. So the five advices that Dhanun al-Misri gives, to recap. One, he says, إِذَا رَدْتَ أَن تَذْهَبَ قَسَاوَةُ قَلْبِكَ فَأَدْمِ الصِّيَامِ. That if you have a desire for the hardness of your heart to leave, then endure in fasting. So in these coming days, start to be smart about how much you eat, what is the quality of your food, and try to fast if you can. The second advice that he gives, if you still find hardness of your heart, فَأَطْلِ الْقِيَامِ, then make the night longer. Pray your five daily prayers. If you are on top of praying the fard of your prayers, add on the sunnahs. If you pray the sunnahs and the fara'id of your daily prayers, pray the qiyam at night. Pray tahajjud. He says, if you still find hardness, then third, فَذَرِ الْحَرَامِ, then refrain from the haram. All of us make mistakes. All of us do things that we're not supposed to. Keep yourself from doing those things as best as you can. And recognize the mercy of your God. If you fall into a mistake, then don't tell yourself you cannot fix it, but your body will go through a weaning process, as will your soul, as will your heart. So if you fall, just stand again. And this is important to understand when you return from your pilgrimage, because the world will call you back. And if the first time you slip, you tell yourself that your entire journey was for nothing, then all you've done is given Shaitan victory. But the companion's strength was not because they did everything perfectly. These were people who made mistakes. Ya Rasulullah, I committed zina. Ya Rasulullah, I drank alcohol. Ya Rasulullah, I kissed a woman I wasn't supposed to. Their strength was derived not from being perfect, but their strength was derived from knowing how to get back on their feet after they fell down. So the third, refrain from that which is haram. Fourthly, he says, if you still find hardness in your heart, then go back and look at your familial relationships and try to mend what you have the ability to. Not for anyone else's sake, but for the sake of your heart. And then fifth, he says, if you still find hardness, فَأَلْتِفْ بِالْأَيْتَامِ, then be gentle to the orphan. Be kind to the orphan. And so specifically, go and do things for orphans right now, but more broadly, take time in your preparation to do things for those who are in need. Not just giving sadaqah, but by being with people who are in need. Walking with people, learning their experiences and their narratives. And that's not to say that you shouldn't give sadaqah, but you want to be ready in a way where it's not something that you're just leaving to chance. The preparation for this journey is not about just reading books, getting all your clothes ready, all the medications, which are things you should do and things that we'll talk about going forward. But the most important part of this journey is an understanding that it is one part of a bigger part that is the journey in this world that is taking you towards your ultimate destination beyond the false realities of this world. So as your body leaves behind its home and its place of work and its place of enjoyment and its friends and everything and goes to physically be with Allah, Your heart has to leave behind similar things as it goes to be with Allah. So inshallah ta'ala, Allah make this a fruitful journey for all of us, one that increases us in the best of ways and returns us back to our homes and our loved ones in a state that is better than what we had left it. Let yourself read the prophetic biography. Be in a place where you take moments to reflect and contemplate so that you can increase in your relationship with yourself and in turn your relationship with Allah, and allow for yourself to understand that this is a journey that's for you more than anybody else. That you don't have to be worried, are you ready for it? Are you right for it? You are. Allah looks not at anything externally, your bodies, your forms, but the hadith says he looks at your hearts and your deeds. So if that's where Allah is looking, then you should start looking there too, and cleansing it, purifying it, and treating it as the most important part of who it is that you are. And so as we close, someone asked, can you repeat the name of the podcast about the Prophet? The podcast is from the Qalam Institute. They have a Seerah podcast. Qalam is Q-A-L-A-M. The Qalam podcast. You can just type it in Google and listen to the whole thing. Sheikh Hamza Yusuf has done a Seerah, a commentary on the prophetic biography. Sheikh Yasir Qadhi has done it. There's a lot of books that are written about the Seerah. There's a lot of audio that's on it. But I would say start to familiarize yourself with it and spend some time listening to it. You're driving in a car, you're riding on the subway, you have time as you're walking between your work, your classes, etc. Put just a portion of it every day as best as you can. Read the Quran in these days. Don't be scared to. It's for you to read. It's not just to be read once a year, but building a relationship with it, letting it be something that you understand is for you more than anybody else. Give in sadaqah, give in charity, perform your daily prayers, fast where you can. And you might say, is it that simple? But yeah, it is. But the distinction is going to be between whether you do it or not. And as best as you can, inhibit yourself from doing those things that you know are just not good to do. So catch yourself in terms of backbiting, catch yourself in terms of lying, catch yourself in terms of what it is that you know are things you can improve upon. There's a lot of different lectures and podcasts that have already been done on this channel through Dar es Salaam. So you can go and surf the channel and find previous things that were being done. Sheikh Abdul Nasir Jangda is going on Hajj this year. He's going to also be doing some sessions on this channel. We're going to be doing some other sessions through the Islamic Center at NYU as well in the coming days as weeks, that you can find info on that on my Facebook page as we're posting them. But feel free to be in touch where it is that I can be helpful if you have questions. And so I'd say as we close, if you can just join me in making a quick dua, inshallah. اللهم آمين اللهم أنت السلام ومنك السلام تباركت ربنا وتعاليت يا ذا الجلال والإكرام اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد في الأولين وفي الآخرين اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وبارك وسلم يا أرحم الراحمين اللهم إنك عفو كريم تحب العفو فاعف عنا يا مقلب القلوب ثبت قلوبنا على دينك اللهم اجعلنا من المخلصين اللهم اجعلنا من المخلصين اللهم اجعلنا من المخلصين We begin this supplication in your name, Ya Allah, and beseech you to send your choicest salutations upon your most beloved sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. We ask that you shower your infinite mercy upon all those who participated in this seminar, granting each and every one of us and our loved ones only the best in this world and the best in the next. We ask, Ya Allah, that for all of those who are going to be performing the pilgrimage to your house, that you accept it from us. that you make us from amongst those who utilize these minutes and hours and days and weeks that are leading up to this pilgrimage to ready ourselves for it in the best of ways possible. That you increase us in all that is good, increasing us in courage, compassion, and confidence, protecting us from affliction, anxiety, and anguish, removing from our hearts any fears or inhibitions, any animosities, any bitternesses, any jealousies or envies, and granting us hearts that are filled with understanding, hearts that are filled with love, hearts that are filled with hope, hearts that are filled with mercy and compassion, hearts that are drawn towards your remembrance, for indeed in your remembrance do hearts find rest. We ask, Ya Allah, that you allow for us to reach this journey, that we have made the intention to perform this pilgrimage. Grant us the tawfiq to be able to walk through the streets that your beloved sallallahu alayhi wasallam walked through. Grant us the blessing of being able to prostrate our head in those places that he prostrated his head, to feel the cool winds of the city of Medina that brought cool, gentle kindness to your Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, that gave him contentment, to be able to feel the ground that he walked on beneath our feet. And help us, Ya Allah, to take from everything that we can of this journey. Ya Allah, grant us the tawfiq to reach your house in the city of Makkah al-Mukarramah, to be able to walk and perform the tawaf around your house in the legacy of our father Ibrahim alayhi salam, to drink the zamzam that was established at the blessed feet of your servant Ismail alayhi salam and his mother Hajar, peace be upon her, to run through the hills of Safa and Marwa, ascending to its very summits as she did, as any mother would do, in pursuit of finding something to provide sustenance to her child who is crying out to her in need. Ya Allah, make us from amongst those whose du'as are accepted, whose prayers are accepted. All of our standing, our bowing, our kneeling, our prostrating, Ya Allah, make it from amongst the best of all of our ritual. Ya Allah, help us to carry in our hearts only those things that are good for us, to remember the names of those people whose names only we know, our families, our friends, our loved ones, who we would at times forget, but this would not be the time to forget them. Ya Allah, protect us from any physical ailment, protect us from any emotional ailment, protect us from any spiritual ailment, any physical ailment that would prevent us or make this journey more harder to fulfill. But let us meet you, Ya Allah, in the best of states. Let us meet you, Ya Allah, with the most awake of hearts. Let us meet you, Ya Allah, in the best of conditions, so that we are starting our journeys from this day, and that when we leave from those places and we return back to our homes, Ya Allah, grant us a safe return and a state that is better than which we had left this place from. Ya Allah, accept our dua. Ya Allah, accept our dua. Ya Allah, accept our dua. Ya Allah, grant us Jannah. Ya Allah, grant us Jannah. Ya Allah, grant us Jannah. Protect us always from hearts that are not humble, tongues that are not wise, and eyes that have forgotten how to cry. Forgive us for our shortcomings and guide and bless us all. رَبَّنَا تَقَبَّلْ مِنَّا إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ السَّمِيعُ الْعَلِيمُ وَتُبْ عَلَيْنَا يَا مَوْلَانَا إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ التَّوَّابُ الرَّحِيمُ وَصَلَّى اللَّهُ تَعَالَى عَلَى خَيْرِ خَلْقِهِ مُحَمَّدٍ وَآلِهِ وَصَحْبِهِ أَجْمَعِينَ بِرَحْمَتِكَ يَا أَرْحَمَ الرَّاحِمِينَ جَزَاكَ اللَّهُ خَيْرٌ. May Allah accept from you and all of us. Please keep me in your du'as as you are moving forward in preparation for this journey. You and your loved ones will definitely be in mine. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi